Good thing about today's show and where I get to do myself is that I have all the pressure off of me. I've got a panelist here of four experienced photographers ready to answer your questions. Now, of course, in my shows, I always like to have a little fun. This is why we have Sapphire here with us, and she'll get to say a few words. So,
a couple.
You want to say anything yet?
A few words.
Okay, a few words. There we go. That's good. And there we go. There we go. You see, we're making this show kind of work through here, but we're getting it. So, hey, what else am I gonna have? Anyway, we've got some great photographers here. It's always great to have you guys here to be, you know, educated or what you're trying to get out of it, you know. And yet, there's so many times that I see that you don't get what you really ask or what you want out of it. So this is where you get to participate more in this program, where you get to ask the questions, and they will, of course, respond. In the middle here, of course, we're going to have a few little prize giveaways and stuff like that, so that'll take a little bit of our time, but that's okay. But definitely it'll keep it fun, and I'm glad you're all here. So on the panel today, I'm here, but I'm not here as answering questions, but if you need to, I can. I've got photos that'll be rolling through here, of course, from our photographers, and there's a couple special ones I want to ask questions of them. But our first panelist is James Pratt here. Wave, James. There he is. There he is. James Pratt, commercial photographer, editorial photographer based in Edmond, and he always has the right answer. He did not become as serious about his photography until he turned 37. Was that just last year? Or, okay, because... But... He also attended a lot of your camera clubs, so he's very familiar with you guys. He's one of us, and as I said, it's nice to see him here. He's done a lot of commercial work for BMW, YMCA, Nike, Harley. His list just goes on and on and on. I read his bio, and I'm going, this is fantastic. So very, very happy to have him here. He's a Nikon shooter, so he's a Nikonian himself, and yet he will use any weapon he needs to make sure to get the job done. Shea Swinford next to him. Yay, Shea. Give it up for Shea. She came in from Kansas City. Now, she is our lonely, only Canonista. So she shoots Canon cameras along with Jeff.
Hey, he's
wielding a Canon.
I'm a Canon girl.
Okay, we got a Canon girl there too. And as you know, I've done Canon, Nikon, Sony. I do it all. So it doesn't bother me. Shay, she does a lot of headshots. She's also, as I say, been in the business for 16 years. She has a beautiful studio. I know where she's at there in Olathe, right? Yep, yeah. And being a Kansas City boy myself, I'm jealous of that little studio and where she's at. So definitely a lot of fun. But as I say, she's a great photographer and is always willing to answer the question, right? Next one over is Debbie Malone, our local favorite here. She's a family photographer. She does babies, families, a lot of that stuff. She's an icon shooter. She's from Moore, Oklahoma. you already celebrate, how many years is it you've been married?
41.
Wow, 41 Woo! Years, so give her that. And her husband's still paying for her photography, so that's good. I mean, so, it's good. And now we've got the younger generation. Now This guy here, I'm really excited about to have him here, Josh Dean. I met him at a photo walk down at the Capitol a couple years ago, and kind of see him shoot, and I go, what's he all about? So started to discover him, learn more about him, and of course, today you will get to learn more about him. He's a student at OSU. He also is a family photographer, weddings, seniors, but has a very creative side to him. So we'll show you those, and then you could definitely have some questions for him. Other than that, we're ready for the show. With this, of course, we're gonna start off with giving our first prize away, okay? So here's what happened when we'll be getting these. I actually had a t-shirt cannon. I was gonna start to launch that here and work it out. It didn't shoot very far. I had problems in the technical part, so today we're just gonna pass these balls around or throw them in the audience here, so everybody needs to stand up.
Right,
stand up, everybody, yep.
You
put your cameras down. You don't wanna get those damaged here. And when I start the music here, you're gonna pass these balls around. You can throw them up, whatever you want to do. You get, here's one for you. And then when it ends, you're either gonna be
look
a
up,
winner
look
or you're gonna be a volunteer.
There you go.
Here it is. So you can't hang on to it because you may get a booby prize. So you gotta be careful. Stop. Hold them. Bring the balls up, okay. Everybody.
Hold your ball up high.
Hold your balls high.
Whoever has it, hold
okay,
it nice
come on
and
up,
high.
Come on up.
Bring your balls.
All right. Come on up, Christy. Come on.
Get to touch your ball here. You also can pick your choice.
Oh.
We want to thank the Sign Shop for producing a lot of our prizes today. We've got water bottles, t-shirts. Whoever gets one of those, grab that cup, mug, and also paper. Woohoo! Because I'm all about the printing. Come on up, step up here. Here's your ball. Thank you. Step down. Good. Next. Keep going. Grab your t-shirts. I'll have Shea here help me out here. Help me out, Shea there. Pass those out. Grab a couple. Definitely.
Okay.
Here we go. She got a 32 good card instead of the paper, so there you go. Everybody needs one of those. Nice.
Go.
Okay. This is how this works. This is how it's going along just fine. Now, instead of asking the gearhead questions, this is your time to ask the questions that are most upon your mind from these photographers. This right here, of course, is Debbie's photo here, but I want to ask... Let's start the question off here. I want to ask this gentleman right here about this photo. Here it is. Wait for it. What inspired you, Josh Dean, about this particular photo? Oops, forget Lightroom there. Hold on. Close it. Yeah, may need that. There we go.
Whoa.
Josh, what inspired you for that photo right there? The one of the gentleman who's holding the, I guess the frame, right? Or a mirror.
Huh?
The frame or the mirror there? Yeah.
He's missing something. Huh? He's missing something in the picture.
What did he do?
Oh, he can't see it. Oh, this is the one of the senior you did with the creative frame where half his body's cut off. Remember the person who's cut in half? His legs are over here and his body's over here. So what inspired you on that particular photo?
I was searching through Pinterest for some interesting ideas for a personal project. Mm-hmm. And I found, I can't remember who the photographer was, but I found them do something similar. And so I just wanted to create my own little image similar to that, so with my style.
I love the whole, creativity. Now, that would make a wonderful senior photo. I mean, come on, that's something nobody's gonna have, right? Gosh has got it. Debbie Malone, I have a question for you to start here. I have a photo here. Now, this may get a little serious real quick, but I do want to ask her about this particular photo right here. Debbie, the one I'm gonna preview here is the one with the hand.
Aww.
I know. Hang on here, people. Remember, I always make you laugh and I make you cry in the same show. Get ready.
Besides doing my regular photography business, I volunteer a lot of services for a company called Now I Lay Me Down to Sleep. For those of you that are not familiar with what that is, we actually are called out 24/7, 365 days a year for a baby that was stillborn or one that has passed away right after birth. Just a lot of, you know, different scenarios with that. This happened to be a stillborn baby, and I don't know, I just found that very touching to see the parents' hands with the baby's hands in there. I know a lot of people think that that might be kind of morbid, but to me, it's just life, precious.
And she's captured that. I mean, that's something, I know it's serious, but you know what? That's what we're all about. We're all about the serious. We're also about the fun. We're about capturing those images that nobody else is going to get, and you're the ones that can do it. That's for sure. Shea, I didn't really have much from you, but tell me about your little photo here. We talked about the lovely couch, the yellow couch. Go ahead, Shea.
So, yes, I run a family photography business in the Kansas City area. And it's funny, we were just talking about this lovely couch last night when we were conversing with Sue Bryce. And my friends that are here with Kansas City brought up the fact that, yes, she has a famous gold couch. And when you see her working in that area, you don't go near that area. But it's part of my business. I brought in a lot of the vintage pieces, and we would use those for inspiring colors to bring our subjects and bring out the best in our subjects. So that's the story of the couch.
Cool, cool, cool. As I said, and again, we all do it. I mean, this is what the client wants. They want what's hip, what's now, what's going on. Sure, you've got to give that to them to pay the bills, you know. Is that kind of what happened to you too or not? Or
absolutely. You've got to do something that's going to set you apart from the competitors. And you really, you want to back into what it is the customer wants ultimately. We were conversing earlier too, it's, you know, it's how you tell the story. And so you, when you're doing a family photo session, you're really creating a story for them. So it's not just necessarily one image that you want to sell, but you want to sell an entire package. So we'll take that couch and we'll put the sisters on it together, and then we'll build have the kiddos jumping from the couch. And so, you know, in our markets, Oklahoma and Kansas City, we don't have a lot of necessarily bridges and props for kids to, you know, to be able to converse or use as our backdrop. So we use creative pieces like the couch to kind of bring that in for the photo sessions.
Cool, cool. James, this one here with the guy in the camo and the camouflaged firearm there, I was impressed with that. What inspired you on that, or what? How did that story? Because I know you do a lot of motorcycles. I call you a real man's photographer. I mean, he's the one who's going to get dirty. Sure, we had the lady photographers here yesterday, and we've got plenty here on the panel. But it's nice to see, you know, some of that nitty-gritty. You probably got dirty in this shoot, too, didn't you?
Yeah, you should see my camera bag. You open it up, and there's my Nikon is coated with mud and scratches all over it, and all the paint's peeled off. So all my gear takes a pretty good beating. They never buy a used camera from me. Actually, they're
never.
Actually, they're really well cared for. I'll put in the ad. They'll say it's used hard, been to Nikon repair service 7 times, and but this we were on a duck hunting deal up. A guy's called me up and said, "Hey, you want to go duck hunting?" And I go, "Yeah, if I can bring my camera." I mean, I like to duck hunt myself, but I want to bring my camera. So I went there, and it was, you know, I don't know if you've ever been duck hunting. It's like 37 below zero or something it feels like, and it's always rainy and it's always muddy, and it's that day was kind of sunny, but it's always nasty conditions. And you take your camera out and you slop through the mud, and you if you ever own a shotgun, you never ever take your really nice shotgun duck hunting because it's going to get nasty. And so anyway, I was out photographing these guys and at the duck hunt and a duck blind, you know, and we're out there all morning, and he was out gathering up some duck decoys, and I photographed him. And actually, I photographed his daughter, and his daughter was like 7. She was with us, and she made the like an inside cover of Outdoor Life, which is kind of the sister publication to Field and Stream. So, yeah.
Cool.
Great.
I love it. I love
fabulous.
It. So now you know a little bit more about what they photograph, what they do. Now's your time to ask those questions. I have my lovely co-host here, Sapphire, who has one of the first questions. Let's raise your hand, and she'll come out to you and help respond to that. We need one first question, because remember, those questions are always worth prizes.
Yes, what is your question?
I want to know how Josh did the picture with the half body.
Josh, how did you do the picture where you kind of slid things over?
On the picture frame?
Right. Yes.
Magical. No, it's it's the composite. So I took a picture of him standing in the frame on where his feet are and where he's at, and then I took a picture without him in there, and I layered all that in Photoshop, masked it out, extended the shadows to make it look more realistic. And I do that with levitation photos as well.
Thank you.
It appears that was shot in Stillwater, is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. Right across the street from Tokyo Pot.
Ah, fabulous. Yes, sir.
You were saying that you had that picture on the inside cover of Outside Magazine?
Outdoor Magazine.
Outdoor Life. Outdoor Life. Did you yourself, how did you get to the editors to be able to get that published?
They actually contacted me on that one. I mean, I work with a lot of different editors, but they actually contacted me. They found it on my website. They searched for photos and called me up. And that's my, it's not my first national publication, but it was the first one in hunting and fishing. And so that was kind of cool. So I was pretty excited to have them.
We had a contest to get an email out
for a while.
The contest show you don't get paid for, so I like to get paid. So. They won't pay. I get paid for. I won't be paid for mine.
Great. Okay. What's your question?
My question to Shay is about the yellow couch. How many people do you have to help you carry that thing around for outdoor shoots?
That is a great question. That yellow couch, I really need 1.5 person to carry it. So I can get it so far, and then I use my body to hoist it into my Suburban. But if you take the cushion off, it's actually a love seat. But yes, my days of, I mean, in the fall sessions, I look like a gypsy because my Suburban, it no longer carries my children, but it carries my chairs, my reflectors, my couch. Some, I have a red one, I have a yellow one, I don't know what other colors I have. It's not surprising, but yes. In fact, that one, I actually can get it into my car by myself. But usually, the customer will kindly help me get it out.
Super. Great. Another question.
There it comes. By the way, here's another one of Josh's levitation photos. I didn't put the one in of him levitating, but I love his levitating shots there. Definitely creative.
I got one for Shay. So how do you keep the kids from moving?
How do you keep the kids from moving?
Big smile. My daughter is always at my granddaughter's say cheese. They
And I want to hear that from Debbie and Shay both.
Well, it's interesting. You kind of get into this trance, and there's noises that come out of your body that you cannot do unless you're actually trying to gather the attention of a 20-month-old who are running the opposite direction of the camera. But it really is a very physical activity. I mean, you're getting down to their level. You're going up. You're Zoom noises. I really can't even tell you because it's such an out-of-body experience that even the parents are like, whoa. Like, what? But we're okay with it. We don't care as long as, you know, the end product, you know, comes alive. But yes, it's just a physical, and it's really getting down to their level, you know, and I ignore them when I first get to my shoot. I ignore the child completely. I mean, there's a whole psychology of working with two-year-olds. And then there's a way of making, and if that's not working, then it's giving them so they have perceived control of the shoot, which really we never give a two-year-old control of a shoot. But
go ahead, Debbie. Is it on?
Okay, Paul, for you, you need to tell your daughter to turn around and walk away and let you deal with the child. And I have done that with numerous parents because the child doesn't know whether to look at the photographer, to look at the parent, the grandparent, whoever's with them. Eliminate as many people as you can to where they have to focus on you as the photographer to do that. Works like a charm.
And plus, don't you think the senior high, if you're doing a senior high shoot, and the parents are getting in the way, and you kick them out of the shoot, and the teenager's like, yeah. We're like, okay, now let's get down to business now that mom's out of here. We're going to have a good time.
Now, wasn't it you telling us about the yellow bus?
Oh, I will get to that later. Actually, Pam's going to talk about that in her session at 2 p.m. Come on out and see
yes,
her. She'll tell you all
you
about that.
Yes, you have to go see her.
She had a great idea of this yellow bus. I was going, yeah.
That's good. That's good. That's
okay,
good.
Yes, ma'am.
Debbie, I want to, first of all, commend you for doing the stillborn photography. My question is, I can only imagine how difficult that is on the parents, and you are giving them a wonderful gift. So my question is, do you think that gives them, I don't want to say a happy moment, because obviously it's a very difficult time for those parents, but do they have a glimmer of hope or something that they can hold on to?
Well, that really is a good question. When I started doing this type of photography and going out and doing that, I literally had to put my game face on before I walked into the hospital room, and I had to view it as a job. However, there have been probably 99 out of 100 times that I ended up crying right along beside the parents, and we have become such good friends. Most of them I'm still friends and in contact with to this day. But yes, because when a parent has a stillborn, the normal reaction or the normal way that things happen is you go home with the newborn baby. These parents don't have the joy of going home with the baby, and it's almost as if they didn't exist other than with these photographs. And so that in itself is the joy that is for them. Does that make sense?
And Debbie, wouldn't you say that for parents who continue after they've had an experience like that, and then they get pregnant again, and they have a baby, and it everything goes as planned, they're actually able to show that that child that made it, you did have a baby sister, or a big brother, or a big sister, and they know that, and it's very real.
Exactly, exactly. And you know, I find it very comforting to me when I go into the home of some of these parents that actually have some of the, well, that one, for instance, there are some that, you know, it's only for the parents to remember and not to display. But that one I thought was beautiful. I mean, beautiful. That's the only way I know how to describe it.
Absolutely. Thank you. Okay, question right here.
My question is for the entire panel. What is your favorite lens and why?
So what is your favorite lens and why, starting with Josh?
A gearhead question. I love it. I love the gearhead questions.
My most favorite is the 70-200. Just primarily, it's great for portraits, the compression. 70 millimeters gets me wide shots, and then I can zoom in and get, you know, tight shots. So
I'm going to cheat. I have two favorite ones. When I'm traveling and doing my fine artwork, I carry a 28-300 because it is very versatile. But when I'm doing mainly families and portraits, I too will use the 70-200.
I also have two lenses that I rely on heavily, and they're the Canon 70-200, primarily so that when the dad's checking out what my equipment I'm using to do the photo shoot, no, just kidding. that has happened to me several times, but it's a good workout too, by the way, carrying that thing around. But also, I would say the 24-70. So.
Well, I'm going to be a little different because I'm all about lightweight and simple, and I want really good lens that's really lightweight. So usually it's my probably either a 50-1.4. That's probably my most favorite lens. Just they're simple, lightweight. I'm doing a lot of real odd things, and I just don't want to carry a lot of gear around. And maybe a 35 f/2 or something. That's what I really like.
Cool. Great. So prime. So thank and you. We saw all those lenses next door. So just go there. All right.
Yes.
Time for a prize giveaway here. I've got. You were handed out playing cards here. Get those playing cards out. We're going to see what you've got here. I've drawn two playing cards here, and we're looking for, of course, I drew out when you know? The Joker. Who has a Joker? Two Jokers? One, two, three. Come on up, people. You Jokers. I want your Joker cards. Come on up here. We've got some prizes for you. You get this and also a choice layer. You also get card, ST card, and also check a couple prizes there. And then, oh, did you get your... Okay, you good. Grab a second one. Grab another card for you. There. And this. Water bottles. And that. And let's see. I think I had one more card here.
Do you like one of those posters?
Okay, thank you. Now, back to questions.
I've got a question right back here.
Oh, here comes a question.
Yes.
I have two questions, one for Josh. What kind of lighting kit do you use whenever you're on location? And then the second question is for everyone. What's your main program for editing portraits?
Okay, for lighting,
thank you.
I started out with some cheap flashpoint strobes from Adorama, and then I upgraded to Alien Bees. And so I use Alien Bees 1600s and 800s. And then I use, with those, I use ND filters to get my f-stop down lower. The editing programs, I use Lightroom, and then I use Photoshop. And I use a couple different plugins in Photoshop. I can't remember what they're called, though. But.
Cool.
I mainly edit in Photoshop. I have Lightroom, but I haven't relied on Mr. Christian to instruct me in Lightroom yet. And I, too, have
some
plugins. Don't worry.
I got that class. You just have to have a meal prepared for me. By the way, that's a hidden talent she has. She actually is quite the chef, I hear. You teach classes in that. Is that correct?
I do.
See? So she's a chef. If you want to learn photography and cooking, Debbie's your gal. There you go.
There is a wonderful plug-in company, and I'm going to plug her. She has no idea I'm going to do that. She's based in Tennessee right now, and her company is called Florabella Collections, and phenomenal things that this woman does, and I use a lot of that if I'm trying to add something different other than just a regular straight photograph.
I use Lightroom, and I don't use any of the presets in Lightroom. I did the best thing I've ever done for me 7 years ago and started working with and sending my work to editors, who changed my life because I could then sleep at night and do more shoots during the day and take care of my family. So my goal is to really get a really nice, clean edit. I don't like a lot of skin softening or sharpening or overlays or enhancements. I feel like, you know, that can really date your image, and that's so I've really gone straight back to really clean edits.
Cool.
For me, it's mostly Lightroom. I have about, I don't know, close to approaching 400,000 images in my archive. And for me, it's real important to be able to find them and pull myself stock, a lot of stock photography. So it's all keyworded captioned. So, and as an editorial photographer, I don't do a lot of edits. Just do, you know, you're real limited on what you can do in most cases. So it's simple Lightroom. I got a really extensive catalog. I can pull a lot of images up. And then every now and then I'll pull it in Photoshop, but not a lot.
Cool. I see you also. We talked about lenses and stuff, and the 7200 seems to be the favorite there of the panel. I, of course, enjoy a prime, too, myself. But you do primes. Okay, two-thirds. See? That's good. Do you guys use any other reflectors like this up here? In fact, Sapphire, let's take a look at this reflector here.
Oh, see, yes.
If that's showing us off a little bit. This is something that we carry, a nice big reflector. Do any of you guys use reflectors? I know shooting by yourselves, it's still difficult sometimes to use something like this. But does what do you guys do?
Well, I used to use reflectors, but anymore I really just end up using strobes. I have a whole lot of strobes.
Uh-oh, hold on. She's having a problem. Can somebody help her there? She's having some problems here. Can anybody help her out here? Anybody? Anybody, Paul? Can you help her out there? Help her up here. She's got a problem here.
It's like a jigsaw puzzle. Can you fold that up?
Let's see if we can fold it. All right, so guess what? Paul is now the proud owner of a nice new reflector. There you go. See, that's what it takes. Audience participation. There we go.
So
he's now the proud owner of a nice reflector. Plus, I like to use this as a diffuser also. You know, you unzip that, you can pull out the diffuser. Yeah.
Treat it like a taco.
There you go.
Bring your arms in. Tuck your tummy. There you go.
So she can do it.
I was acting.
Now, finish your answer there, James. Very good.
Okay, so I say I used to use reflectors. I still do some, but I mostly use strobes because I can control them a lot more. So I can bring the power up, bring the power down very specifically with my strobes. So not so much anymore, but I used to.
I absolutely use a reflector. And in some cases, it helps to divide the parents from the children.
I very seldom will use a deflector because I normally don't carry one with me. I forget to grab it out of the other camera bag, so I use a person as a deflector.
I keep two in my car, and I actually never use them unless I'm in studio. I mainly use the strobes on location, one to two strobes.
Wouldn't you agree that their photography reflects that they do or do not need a reflector?
There you go, there you go. We have a question here, Sapphire.
Quite a big question, and they have to do with a better lens. But I've been always trying to get a good picture of the moon. And I see.
How to take a good picture of the moon?
Who's my astrophotographer up here on stage? Is there somebody? I know there is.
I think I photographed the moon once, so I don't know.
Actually,
I couldn't tell you.
I have like people over here who specialize in taking shots of the moon. Jeannie, would you stand up, please? Or if you would like to appoint, actually, Dave, would you stand up and tell us about how you photographed the moon? Because he has some amazing moon shots.
SO 100, 1/125th of a second at 5.6 is a pretty good starting point, and you can the exposure equivalent of that, but. If you want the character of the moon, the craters, and all that sort of stuff, the bigger the lens, the better.
Yes. So ISO 100, f-stop 5.6. Yes. And shutter speed?
1/100th, 1/125th, something like that. So.
Stop there and dial it down and use your tripod.
That's worth a water bottle and a coaster.
Yeah,
for our audience participation. Congratulations, did a good job.
No, you're awesome.
Thank you, thank you. See, again, I think this is where you get more out of this when you guys participate and get into it instead of us just up here entertaining. We have one from Mark, but we have one back there first. Go ahead, Sapphire, the one next to you.
Okay, go right ahead.
This is for Jane. When you were first starting into commercial photography, how did you start contacting the editors and finding them?
Well, it's an interesting story. When I first started into it, I couldn't get anybody to publish my stuff because I didn't know what the heck I was doing. And so I just started my own magazine. And because then I couldn't get turned down, right? You know, I could get anything I wanted published that way. And I kind of learned what editors needed because then I couldn't photograph everything. So I'd start having people submit to me and some really, really good photographers and editors. And I could start seeing what makes a good package. And so then I, after that, I started, doing some marketing. I would, I think I tell this a lot. It's all about the story. And so you don't sell pictures to magazines. You sell stories to magazines. They don't buy pictures. They buy stories. And so I really started packaging up stories and presenting to people, not pictures. And the stories happen to have pictures in them to tell the story. And I would team with various writers, and we'd pitch a story idea. And that's when they started getting my work out a lot, is it's all about the story itself. And your photos then have to tell that story of what you were doing. And then now I use, you know, LinkedIn, and I go through the Barnes & Noble sound and get all the magazines out and find out who the masthead, you know, and get all that information and put it in my database, and I go cross-reference it and get their contact information and send out marketing pieces.
Okay.
There was Mr. Mark Zimmerman has a question here. Go ahead and shout it out, Mark.
So the eyeball photographs, whose are those and what's the story?
Whose eyeball photographs are those? Anybody over here? They're mine. Sorry. Okay, one question. I will answer only one question. The eyeball project was a very interesting project. It's also a project that's had my boss pulling his hair out. That's why he's shaved his head, of course. You can see that. Because it definitely was a project I enjoyed. I got to go to the Science Museum of Oklahoma, and they have a new micro photography display there at the museum. They have a brand new entrance, which is the old entrance, remodeled. So that's going to be open up here, I think, tomorrow, brand new. So if you want to check that out, a lot of neat art, photography combination there with that. I shot that with also 100 millimeter macro with extension tubes. I used a strobe in their eye. And then to make their iris get smaller, their pupil get smaller, I actually had them hold their iPhone with the flash in their light. So I really got that eyeball focused so I could see that color and the depth and stuff. Now they're 4 foot big eyeballs hanging up from the museum there. So when you walk in, you'll see them. You can't miss them. That's me. But I think the cooler detail is the smaller photos that are actually shows more of the makeup and the eyelashes and the eyebrows. That's the cool part. But I was just very privileged to be part of that. Some of those images, they actually paid $400 per image for the cancer cell dividing, for the horse's tongue or hoof, for somebody's tongue. They paid a lot of money for a lot of those images on that wall. Me, of course, they didn't have to pay. So, but it's fun to be able to participate with that group and that organization. Very good a partner of ours. And if you want, check out some science and get some cool photography look at. That's for sure. Cool.
So we had another question back here.
I think we had one back there. I thought, where to go? There it is. Here it is. She is right here.
Thank you, by the way, for Yosemite. Saw that in there. How did you get started? You started late in life. What inspired you to start?
That's funny. So that's a funny story. I used to be in the computer business. I still did some. Went to the 96 Olympics with IBM and got these awesome seats right up front with boxing and women's gymnastics. And so, by gosh, I'm going to get me a camera and take me some cool pictures because I got these cool seats. So I got me back then it was a Minolta, I don't know, some type of a really expensive lens and a really good camera. And I took a whole bunch of pictures and they turned out like crap. They were horrible. Then I figured out, it's really not necessarily the camera. It's the person taking the pictures. And that kind of got me started doing photos, and I started figuring out, I got to get better at this. And so I started I went to a lot of camera clubs. I'm a member of all the camera clubs here, and I've been to them for years and participated and learned, and that's kind of how I got started.
You have a question right back here.
For everyone, like, right now, who's your favorite photographer to follow or to inspire you?
Who do you admire? Who's the one you follow now? I follow all you guys. So that's what I do. So who's the one that inspires you?
Probably for me. I mean, there's a lot of them. You know, there's a lot of really good photographers for me. Probably Joe McNally. He's just a real inspiration. He's funny, and he's does a lot of really interesting things, which I like to. I want to be Joe McNally. And I even have the same boots as Joe McNally.
Now, Joss has got some cool shoes. Show those off here right now first. This is your signature. Can everybody see them?
No.
Get higher, them up there.
Higher.
Those are great.
Oh, wish you orange, people. Go, folks.
Well, I recently branded a new business called the Headshot Studio. So for 16 years, I was photographing real people, real subjects, coaching them, and pulling out the story I wanted to tell about them. But after chasing two-year-olds around for 16 years, I realized this probably I need to maybe transition a little bit of my business so I'm not so heavy in the baby market. So I went into corporate photography, and I started looking at great headshots. And I was like, okay, if I'm going to become a headshot photographer, which I never in a million years, if you would have asked me that even a year ago, I would have said, no way, never, not even interested. I would have said, you know, I got on the internet and I said, I wanted to know who was the best headshot photographer in the world. And up came Peter Hurley. Woo, woo. And so, and if anybody knows Peter Hurley, he's got a ton of energy. He's dynamic, he's funny, he's ADD. I don't mean there's just so many components of him, but it really brought me into viewing this, that you really, if you're gonna craft a really great headshot, it's more than just taking a mugshot of a person. You wanna capture their authentic self. So with that said, since I probably in my former days would have said Sue Bryce, which is still super inspiring. Obviously, everybody heard her last night. She's amazing because she's so passionate about what she does. But with my new venture, I'm going to have to say Peter Hurley.
Peter!
I think we got some Peter fans in the club here.
I met Shea through the headshot crew. We'd gone to Kansas City one weekend, and then I'm on the weekly spree cast with Peter Hurley, and I see this Shea Swinford, Kansas City. I'm like, we were just in Kansas City! So I like send her an instant message, and like, hey! I'm like, you're not far from me! And so we just like struck up a friendship, and it's like a community that's been fantastic, and now I've hired her retoucher, and it set me free! So, but...
And that's what's nice about the photography community. We don't have to compete against each other. We can actually support each other, as far as that goes,
too. And especially with headshots, because the last time we checked, everybody that needs a headshot has got a face.
Yep, yep.
So,
cool.
There's plenty of room for all of us. Start taking headshots.
Unless you're Sapphire.
Oh, you need a couple faces. Correct, correct. Yes.
Go ahead.
Excuse me?
Who's your retoucher?
Her name is Diana. That's the only thing I know about her. I send my files to Shea and it happens.
Go ahead, Debbie.
Talk to Shea afterwards.
Mine is probably somebody that none of you may have even heard of, and by chance, I had been hired to photograph the Super Bowl in New Orleans many years ago. Did all of the parties leading up to the Super Bowl and the Super Bowl ball game. Do you know how many female photographers are on the sidelines of the Super Bowl?
How many?
Me.
Good.
And that's why when I'm looking through the lens and I lean back because I fear I've seen them come at me one too many times. But I met a lady in, a bar there the night before the game. And her name is Winnie Denker, D-E-N-K-E-R. You need to Google her when you go home, please. She was born in Denmark, lives in Paris. I've been to her home in Paris. She lives right at the base of Sacré-Cœur. And has probably 50 books published through Time Life. She is the Eiffel Tower person and St. Petersburg, Russia person. Phenomenal lady. She is 80 years old and my dearest friend.
I follow several. One is Zach Arias, where I learned a lot of my lighting. And then I follow Sal Cincotta for his business side of things. And then also I follow my really good friend, Bradley Cheatwood, photography.
Would you repeat the first photographer for everyone? Zach Arias.
Cool. Now, we've got a little pinhead mannequin here. Sometimes we use these in our industry, you know, for checking shadows. I use them in my class and stuff like that. But I've got a lot of hair coming out of that. When I need some help pulling those out. There are several toothpicks there that are painted with my wife's fingernail polish. And if you pick one out, you get a prize. So let's pass that around here. Go for it.
Okay. This is Sapphire's cousin, by the way. Doesn't have as good a hair as Sapphire.
There you go. There you go.
Could you go ahead and pick one out?
And by the way, I've tried to do the whole mimic of the Peter Hurley, too. Not close to their level, but...
Oh, we have a winner.
We all do headshots. Oh, we have a winner.
Yes,
there it is,
Mr.
Zimmerman. He gets 200 free print counts and also, of course, prizes here from the sign shop.
Oh.
T-shirts are gone. Pass those out. Good job. Water bottle and there you go. Congratulations. Next one. Keep going. Keep going.
Right.
How many colored pins are there?
Get on the other side of the room.
Pass
and
around.
And if you get one of the color, hop up and go up front. There you go.
Pull them out. Pull them out.
There you go. You're like, oh, don't
get
me.
Oh, here we go. Here's one. I got one up here.
Gotta
hold
win.
On.
Awesome.
Hold on. Wait for it. Here we go.
Right.
Good.
Let
good
go
job.
Another.
What's your name?
Marianne.
Marianne. She got one here, so here's your tuner
right.
count.
So you
prints and also your water bottle and coaster. Yeah. There you go. You know what? I even have an extra for you. Come here. Come here. Oh. Now, this is a little concentration. She's going to have to assemble this. The sign shop even makes clocks, but you have to assemble
right
yourself.
Run to the other
so
side.
Here's a clock for you. There you
quickly,
go.
Quickly, quickly, quickly.
Help keep your time there. There you
it
go.
It won't bite. It won't bite. Okay, let's get in the back of the room here. Go. All right. Go. Okay. Oh, she's getting up for it. We'll let her have the card ahead. Fabulous.
Should be one last one in there. I'm waiting for it. One last one.
All right,
one.
Go right ahead.
There it is.
All right.
Coming up.
Here you go.
Wait for it.
Save it for after lunch. They may come in handy.
Wait for
there
it.
There you go. Did you get one? If you have color, just run right up front there.
If you got it, come on up. Should be one more, one more.
All right, here you go. Yes. You go right ahead.
One more.
Okay, there you are. All right, one more, go ahead. There you are. All right.
One more.
How are we doing there, Christian?
We're getting there. There should be one still left.
Should we keep plucking on poor little cousin here?
See it?
Go. Okay. Any luck? Oh man. Cousin's got a little bit of a headache.
Is there a color?
Yeah. Any color on that? No. Denied. In the last row here. Go ahead, pick a stick. Anyone there? There you are. Fabulous. On the other side.
Okay. While we're still picking out the one color, I also have a prize. For all of you, or actually, all of you get to have another chance at it. Underneath your chair, there is something taped. Do you have anything taped underneath
your
chair?
We got a winner.
Take a look.
Woo!
There. Oh, we got a winner finally. Come
front.
On up. Come on up. She's the winner of the cards in there.
All right.
Take a look under those chairs. You got anything? Anybody have anything?
I don't know.
Oh, there we go. There's what also, what does she have there? Okay. She's got a free week long lens rental from Bedford Camera Video. Congratulations. You did good.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. How many do we have? Oh, good. So you get to keep that. You keep that, you bring it back to store, you get a free lens rental. So, that's from leftover. I'm sorry. Here. Now, if you pull the stickers off the chair, those don't count, but she got one because she went ahead and got the water bottle and the coaster from our sign shop. He did a good job. So where's my head now? Where did it go? Oh, is it hiding over here?
Oh, yes.
Say, we've got, we've got this. We just need to find somebody who looks like they need this in their portrait photography. Who needs a head with their portrait photography? Here comes my co-host. She's going to pick one of you guys. Stand up if you think you need a head for your portrait photography.
Right
there. So she's picked it.
First one.
Good job. Guess what? You get the tie, the head. No. And you get the monopod attached to it.
You get the
congratulations,
whole thing.
Sir.
Oh my goodness.
You got the monopod, the box, and everything. Give it all to him. He gets it all. So he's going to start doing his headshots now, right there. So he's part of it. Was that easy?
It was the girl behind him.
We're going to have one more prize left, but let's go ahead and get a couple more questions here before we do that last one. Here, I've got one here from this gentleman right here. Shay is one for James.
Yes, James. What model Nikon camera do you shoot with, and why did you pick it?
I shoot with a whole bunch of Nikon cameras. My favorite by far is my Nikon DF, and it's got the D4 sensor, and it's a little bitty tiny thing compared to the bigger cameras. My most used probably is the, I have a D3S. I would like to have a D4, but I think Christian was giving those as prizes for the panel here.
I used that one.
That's my understanding
anyway. So I'm very familiar with that camera.
I have
very familiar.
I've had D800, but it's got the, it had the back busted off. I had to, since an Nikon, they couldn't repair it, so I screwed it back together, and it's all held together, and I still shoot with it. I've had a variety of Nikons, and that's, I mean, I shoot with a lot of stuff. I shoot with Pentax and 4x5, and I shoot with a, I got a Sony A7R, and I've shot with Canon, and one problem with Canon is they put the damn buttons in the wrong place.
You know, it's always opposite.
I mean, they're great cameras. They take awesome pictures, but somebody put the buttons in the wrong place. Because, you know, with an Nikon, you know, you can spin them with your eyes closed. You know where they're, what you're doing.
Well, see, that's Canon and Nikon do that on purpose, I'm sure. So, to confuse you, that's for sure. That's for sure. You had another question over here, didn't you? Okay. Another one. Go ahead. Her right there. The one in front.
Go ahead.
Well, I want to know, what was your most difficult subject and what did you have to do to get the picture?
My new transition, so everything's a little bit more complicated for me because I'm now working with real subjects that really don't like to have their picture taken. And so it's getting them to bring their neck out, as Sue was showing us last night, bringing their head down, and they're going, and so I had this client come in, gentleman, who did not like to have his picture taken. It was like he wanted to look everywhere but right in my camera for a headshot. And it's intimidating because the lighting is right in your face. But I literally use a coaching device now because I had to say, okay, just to get him to into position, I had to take a picture. I'm like, okay, let me take a picture of how you think you look or you should look. So we took it, and he's, of course, like this, you know, your neck and all this stuff is showing. And then I said, now let me take a photo of what I'm trying to get you to do, which he like, it hurts. I can't get my neck out there and down. And just, I can't do that. I'm not yoga. And then, so we got him as far as he could go, and we brought him back around and took the picture. And so it took me just coaxing him and getting him and to trust that I was going to actually try to take the best picture that I could of him at that very moment.
So. I bet Debbie's got a difficult situation, don't you, Debbie?
Mine's going to be a two-part answer to that. The most difficult shoot I think I probably ever had was for a young lady doing her senior pictures, and she was very shy, very ashamed of the way she looked. She was extremely overweight. We talked about a lot of things during the shoot. So I kind of talked her a little bit out of, you know, well, you're beautiful. You need to, you know, just let me photograph how I photograph, not what you think you want to do. So we spent 2.5 hours walking around a park doing what I wanted to do. When she picked up her proofs, and I'll try not to cry, the first thing she said to me was, I actually look beautiful. So it was hard, but it was so worth it. Does that kind of answer your question?
It's good. It's good.
My most difficult was a baby. It didn't take my directions very well and didn't shoot one since then.
I know, he's aversion to babies, but someday, I know, we'll get him there, don't worry. So, but he does great with seniors, so he's good at that. Don't worry, those babies will become seniors, and you've got them. You've got them covered there.
Well, mine was actually an assignment. I was photographed from most physically demanding. We rode dirt bikes from Canada to Mexico along the Continental Divide Trail, and we spent a week, and we camped out, and there's about 30 people, and I was doing a story about it, and I had to ride dirt bikes, and so we'd start out in the morning. I'd have to get up before everybody else, take pictures of them, breaking camp and do all that stuff. We'd jump on the bikes. I'd race ahead. I'd just leave first. They'd all blow by me, and I'd take pictures of them, and then I had to get my gear back on, and I had to jump on my bike, and there's some pretty fast riders, and so I had to ride like 100 miles an hour on dirt trails and stuff, pass them all, get front, set up again, take pictures again. And then we'd stop for lunch, and I had to back up my cameras and everything while they're all relaxing and eating lunch. And then when at the end of the evening, we get back to camp, they'd all kick back and have a beer around the fire while I'm backing up cameras and charging batteries and trying to set my tent up late at night. And, you know, it really wore me out. The most challenging for me was I had to shoot the Oklahoma High School Debate Championships.
Now, anybody ever try to make debate look exciting? I mean, can
They're
you arm
right
wrestle
now,
or something? Or, you know, can you, is there any, like, full contact? How do you make debate look exciting? That's really challenging up here.
Very nice, very nice.
Yes.
I am looking for those cards again. Pull out your playing cards. I'm looking for an exact playing card. There's one of you. I want you to stand up. What is that, an eight of
this
diamonds?
This is an eight of diamonds.
Eight of diamonds. Who has
exactly.
eight of diamonds? I want you to stand
eight
up, your eight of diamonds. Who has
yes.
eight of diamonds? And it must match this. Must match this one
let
because
me,
this
let
price.
Let me tell them about the prize.
Go ahead. You tell them. Tell them. Go
the
for it.
The prize is a black, a black rapid strap, which is fabulous.
Black rapid. Ooh.
Yes. And let's nice. See. Does it match exactly? Oh, it looks like a similar pattern. Ah! It's a match.
Match your match.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. Good job. Good job. Don't worry, I have one more just like that. That'll be the final grand prize, which we can also thank GoPro for giving us a Hero 7 to give away for our show. So you guys were good. Get those playing cards ready. Mm-hmm. Not yet. Question? Next question, please.
I have a question for the panel.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
Okay. How would you get away, James, question for James, how would you get away with forgetting your wedding anniversary?
How would I get away?
How would you get away with
how
it?
How do you get away?
Did I get away?
How would you get away with it?
I know, that was a tough question,
well,
too. So.
I've been married a really long time, so for me, I treat every day as my anniversary.
Aww. Oh.
Guy's breaking my
very
heart.
Very good, very good.
Oh, he's killing
okay.
me. I've been married 9 months now, and he just set the bar too high for
yes,
me.
Yes.
There's my lovely wife over there hiding her head.
Fabulous.
So there you go. Thank you. Thank you, James.
Next question for Shay. Shay, how would you get away with a speeding ticket?
I would.
Hold the mic up nice and close. So
yes,
we can hear.
Hold the mic up close.
I would sit up very tall, put hands 10 and 2, and say, yes, sir.
Very good. Very good,
good answer. Debbie.
Debbie. This is going to be hilarious.
Good.
Debbie, how would you get away with forgetting someone's name?
I work with an architect, and the way that he, the first few times I thought, man, this is weird. He keeps saying, well, Debbie, well, Debbie. Well, Debbie, well, I know now why he does that, because it's embedded in his brain after saying it 5,000 times within a meeting. So I would say, well, Sapphire, well, you know Sapphire, you know Sapphire?
Excellent, excellent. And Josh, what is the weirdest scar you have and how did you get it?
The weirdest scar?
Weirdest scar.
The weirdest
behind
scar.
Behind my ear. The scar?
Yes, yeah. How did you get it?
From here to here. I was running and my ear got caught on a fence.
Oh!
Just kidding, just kidding.
Oh!
You know,
no.
That hurts so much, I'm going to give him a water bottle, you know?
No, I was born with holes in my eardrums, and so this side healed, but this side didn't, so they had to skin graft my eardrum.
Wow.
So they had to cut my ear off to do that.
Wow.
So.
Yikes.
That is amazing. You know, that was totally a random question by Sapphire, because that's just how she works, you know?
that's how we get those
Thank
questions.
You.
One last question from the audience. Here we go. Yes, go ahead, ask.
What would you say is your biggest trick of graphic photography? The biggest trick? Yeah. What makes
Well, in the studio or outdoor? What would you, which way do you want to go with it?
In the studio.
Okay. So I'm very prepared, and so much that when I consult with my client prior to, we talk about all the things that we could go down the rabbit hole with a two-year-old, in the sense that the binky stays in the car, the blankie stays in the car, the shoes stay in the car. Because those are things that we don't want to contend with once they've walked into my space. And when they walk into my space, you know, there's an area with the dressing area. We keep it very confined and contained so they can only, you know, see what's in this little space while the mom and I are conversing about what we're going to accomplish at this shoot. At that point, we get, when we have the toddler ready, if I feel like I can convince the toddler to follow me to the other area of my studio by herself or himself, then I will go that route first. That doesn't always happen with a two-year-old. So, but that is certainly, you know, again, taking the parent out of the picture so that they will focus on you. So I think just really knowing and taking control, and I miss Shay to them because they have been introduced by teachers, or when they're told to make introductions, they call them Miss for their teachers or any of those preschool teachers. So I do, I call myself Miss Shay. So it kind of just sets the bar that they're in my space and we're going to do what I want to do, but we're going to have fun doing it. Does that answer your question?
Cool. Okay, here we go. Now, my lovely, there, hold this. Ooh, nice. Ooh, anybody want to touch it?
Says,
I have a card in my hand. Does everybody have their cards here? My card is the Queen of Spades. It must match.
Ooh,
my Queen of Spades. All those who have Queen of Spades, stand up, and let's see
back.
If it matches. Let's see if it matches. Now, wait for it. If it doesn't match, or we don't have that card out, I will draw another one. So, hold your breath. Not too long.
We
hold
have
your
two
breath.
Queen of Spades. Let's see. That's a heart, right? No, that's a spade. Whoop, that's a spade. Does it have like the W?
No.
Does it match? Does it kind of look like
does
that?
Does it match that one? Can I see that one again? Oh, no, that doesn't match. Who
doesn't
else
match.
Has a Queen of Spades?
Doesn't match. Okay, I'm going to have to draw another one. Anybody? Queen of Spades?
Oh.
Yeah, somebody draw again. Hurry up.
He says draw again.
I'll draw again.
I'm going to take his word for it because if it was not legit, he would just say, oh, that's sure. Thank you very much.
Here we go. Drawing.
Do you want Sapphire to pick him?
Yeah, let's let Sapphire
all right.
pick.
Oh, come on,
go ahead.
High.
Pick from my box there. There we go.
You're very awesome.
Looking good. It's the?
The Two of Spades.
Two of Spades. We're still
two
on spades. Stand
Woo!
Up, two of spade people. Stand up.
Stand
it
up,
must match.
Legs. It must, be
it must match,
match
for that grand prize of that
Let
GoPro
see.
Hero 4.
Let me see.
Lovely camera. Does it match? Does it match? Hold your breath.
Oh my gosh, it matches.
It matches. We have a winner. Congratulations to her. Fantastic.
Thank
Congratulations. You did a great job.
Yes.
In fact, right now I want to thank my panel for what they did. Congratulate them. They did a good job.
Yes, thank you.
And if you have any other questions, you can talk to them. Once again, we thank you for coming to the show. The rest of the expo is for you guys. You have a great day. Take care now.